From Crack Transit, which is a national nonprofit group, and I work closely with them on a lot of issues. We work pipelines. Ted is actually from Indianapolis County and flows over our entire Rover pipeline. And so we have a baseline for pipelines too. And we work throughout Ohio and other communities and sharing information so that you can protect yourself. The information is going to be truthful, and you're going to walk out of here going, what are they doing to us? So from 6 to 7, Ted's going to do the presentation, and we'll have a half hour for answering questions. And if you haven't signed the sign-in sheet, that's how we'll communicate, and we will get emails out to you of future events and so that we can keep together, and we can help this community to grow in the right direction. So Ted, you're on.
Yeah, so as Elaine said, I work with a nonprofit called Frack Tractor. This isn't really going to be a pro or an against fracking slide presentation. That's not what I'm doing. What I'm doing is trying to quantify the complete suite of effects that oil and gas development is having on Eastern Ohio, West Virginia, and some other states in this, like Wisconsin and Minnesota. There's a bunch of ways that you can look at fracking. You can look at it economically. You can look at it, you know, the cost benefits economically, the cost benefits from a health perspective, from a landscape perspective, and all sorts of other different things. But the three kind of pillars of the way that I'm looking at fracking is water, waste, and land use, and a little bit on the air front. But primarily what I want to understand is, what is the effect of this industry on water, both water quality and quantity, waste, production, disposal, and transport within Appalachia and across state boundaries and within the state of Ohio with respect to our landfills and our injection wells. And then one thing that's near and dear to my heart, my background as a scientist looking at mine reclamation and strip mountaintop removal in West Virginia is land use change. When you pull out something from the ground, whether it's a fossil fuel or it's a commodity or whatever the case may be, there's an input demand there, right? So what economists like to call energy return on energy invested. It's the amount of energy you have to put in to get a unit of energy out of somewhere. And that's basically the way that we look at fracking, or the way that I look at fracking in Ohio and West Virginia and some other states. I should say, if there's any questions as I go, I kind of dig into some charts and graphs that can be kind of complicated and kind of cumbersome. But if there's any questions as we go, you know, we have the time afterwards, but you can just ask me. But more importantly, Frack Tracker's goal isn't really to kind of come in on the pro or the against fracking. We're kind of a data organization, a mapping organization. Our primary goal is to highlight or to identify and highlight the data gaps with respect to oil and gas development. And when we can't fill in those data gaps by way of mapping or data compilation or data set creation, whether it's pipelines, compressor stations, sand mines in Wisconsin, whatever the case may be, when we can't fill that gap in, we write about it, we write in a peer review format, we write on a blog, we write on other formats to try to bring light to these gaps. Especially here in Ohio, I'm really concerned about the lack of transparency, the lack of data quality and quantity as it relates to the water, waste, and land use impact of fracking. So what I've been writing a lot about is these effects. There's a couple of bills that are coming down the pipe here in Ohio that really concern me, specifically regarding waste disposal, HB 578 and SB 165. These are bills that are really designed to grease the skids for fracking waste disposal and transport and just disposal, right? And what those bills do, SB 165 and HB 578, and then there's a companion bill in the Senate for the 165 basically is basically designed to create a commodity class for oil and gas waste disposal. So we're converting something that could possibly be radioactive, speaking to the lack of what we know about something, and making it a commodity, like the commodities we're all familiar with. HB 578 is designed to monetize and incentivize communities to take in waste within the state. From West Virginia and Pennsylvania. We already take in all their waste because they don't want to dispose of their fracking. We do that for them, but now we're trying to kind of have a race to the bottom by this HB 578. This actually was constructed by some guys in Trumbull County, which you know better because we've got all these injection wells in Trumbull County. I just wanted to give you a sense for where we are in the state right now. This is a monthly graph of total permits in the state of Ohio, total Utica permits, going back to September 2010. I've been keeping this graph for a long time. The blue line, this big blue line that goes way up and comes way down, that's the monthly permitting trend. The red is the cumulative permitting trend up to February 2018. This purple line is an interesting line because this is average oil and gas price, Brent crude price, going back to 2010. So you can see there's a nice tight line between permitting and the price signal that they're getting at globally. And indeed, since Donald Trump was elected, there has been a little bit of a bump, but you know, it's hard to see, but indeed there has been a little bit of a bump since then. But this is not really also a political discussion, because what I would argue is that the bills that I just mentioned to you, those are actually proposed by Democrats. So this is a really bipartisan interest in getting as much out of this out of Ohio's ground as we possibly can. And what I would say is at the expense of residents and at the expense of our ecosystem. A lot of what I do the work that I do has ended up being, I've become kind of a photographer. I love doing it. I think it's really powerful. I've had the opportunity to fly over much of eastern Ohio and several other states to photograph fracking developments. And the reason that I do this is two-pronged. One is, my wife always says, you have to have more pictures in your presentation. You're just kind of really data-heavy and people just glaze over, which, please don't glaze over yet. It's too early to glaze over. But people glaze over, and I said, you know, that's fair enough. And so how do I do that? Well, one of the ways that I like to do that is I like to get up in planes at about 1,000 feet and fly over and see what I see. And I do that by way of a partnership with a nonprofit called LightBomb, which is a group of pilots that donate their time and their planes for environmental causes. And one of the reasons that the other reason I do that is because you can't really understand the true extent of land use change, water demand, water disposal from this industry if you can only get it from the air. A perfect example would be, this is a typical well pad. This is in Belmont County right here. This is your typical Ohio well pad. This is the actual well pad right here, which you have access road, you have water impoundments, you have wastewater impoundments, you have gathering lines. You can see here, here's an oil gas, this is the gas gathering line. This is also in Belmont County. It's connecting to a drill rig right here. This was about 2 months ago. You have class two injection wells like the Danny Long well in Stark County, which is a nasty, nasty site. This is a class two injection well just north of Columbus in Morrill County. And then you have all this huge infrastructure that's being built out here in Ohio now in the name of gas processing, transport, and just kind of, you know, more fully realizing the profitability of the gas revolution in the state of Ohio.
So are there pipelines from every frack well then? Do they have to pipe it that way to the big line?
That's a great question. So there is some critical threshold with respect to number of pads, proximity of a pad to other pads, and the production of a given pad, whether it's individual wells or the pad itself, whereby you get the need for gathering lines, these gas gathering lines, which I'll talk about. And what that critical, go ahead.
Have you done any work in Pennsylvania? Because some of the people down there, they said the company won't share lines, and some of them had 10 pipelines through one farm, and they couldn't farm any of it.
Well, I can tell you that in Noble County, in Guernsey County, where I spent quite a bit of time, that seems to be the case,
right?
What you just mentioned.
They won't share lines.
But they don't share
lines. They all
line.
Have their own totals.
Right.
So when you get the competing companies, like what I've heard, there's over 100 companies competing for leases in Ohio right now.
Yeah, that's about right. And the other thing to keep in mind is these gas gathering lines, and we'll talk extensively about in a minute, these are not the FERC-regulated transmission pipelines that you all are hearing about. We're very close to the Roper pipeline here, the Utopia, the Nexus. Those are FERC-regulated. For whatever you might think about FERC or federal regulation or the size of government, that's not the point here. The point here is these gas gathering lines are not regulated at all. They're intra-county or even within two or three county gas gathering lines that the counties can barely keep up with. Okay, so these are not designed, they're not invoking eminent domain, they're just creating a really big rush for pipelines, because what they've done is they've told the people that didn't make out on the fracking boom that you too can make out on this boom with respect to gathering lines. So there's an incentive there for folks to.
And do those lines fall under the self-regulation?
Yeah.
I've heard that there's only like one inspector for several counties for the frack site.
Yep. Yeah, we, well, not about that, but not one, but not enough.
What the pipe might fall under the self-regulation rule.
Right, right. And what, and kind of, let's just keep this a little bit organic. Your point about inspectors, the number of inspections we have in the state of Ohio for pipelines or frac pads is in no way coupled to this trend. It's a fixed number. So what does that mean? That means the ratio of active pads to inspectors just keeps going up, just like this number's going up.
Right.
So you have the same state. The inspector number is static over time. The permit is up, so that ratio of responsibility for the number of pads just keeps going up. So these guys are running faster and faster just to stand still, if that makes sense. So this gives you a full extent of kind of what we're talking about, but just finishing up this slide. So then you have this mega infrastructure. This is a Mark West. No, that's Blue Racer. That's in Noble County. This is a Blue Racer facility that's connected to the gathering line infrastructure that Blue Racer's been building. This, if any of you have heard about the big Shell Beaver cracker plant in Beaver County, Pennsylvania, that's that right there. So now we've gotten to the point where all the low-hanging fruit has been gotten. And now what you're seeing the industry do is kind of creating areas around like the Appalachian Storage Hub. We have $100 billion in investment from China for this Appalachian Storage Hub, which is going to maximize the amount of gas we get out of Appalachia, store it whenever necessary, and then get it out to the global market. But to do that, you need this mega infrastructure. We're talking about 300, 400 acres. This parcel right here is like 670 acres right here. These are massive, massive pieces of infrastructure being put in all along the Ohio River. So we're not just talking about a 4 or 5 acre well pad in Carroll County anymore. Now we're talking about tremendous build-out of land use change, and that's been one of my big things. And then finally on this slide, it's important to point out, and this is not a data-driven graph right here, this is just a theoretical way that I look at it. Oil and gas production in our wells in Ohio drops off by about 80 to 85% from year one to year two. So these are short-lived wells, 5, 7, 10-year wells, okay? Now the problem with that is, you see these exponential declines in production from year one to year two over time. But over time, they're using more and more resources to get the same amount of resource out of the ground. So what does that mean? That means that ratio of energy inputs to energy outputs is going up, which means that the way in which we're getting something out of the ground, a lot of people would argue that this was a very inefficient, wasteful way of getting oil and gas out of the ground, and it's becoming more so. So the big knock against this industry was inefficiencies. Resource inefficiencies, labor inefficiencies, capital inefficiencies, and all of those inefficiencies are just being amplified right now. Go ahead.
I read that it takes 1 barrel of oil to produce 2.
Right. And then...
And is that a wastewater pit up there or a freshwater pit?
That's a freshwater pit.
Now, you probably can't see this from your plane, but I've read a lot of information about these wastewater pits that would be just like this, that they actually slice the liner in the bottom so that they'll just constantly drain into the ground. And also, I wanted to ask you if you knew that Ohio was raising the level for radiation acceptable for landfills.
Yeah, that is true. And well, why are we doing that? Because they are experiencing
solid waste.
Yeah, it's a solid waste thing, and we're seeing that the stuff is indeed hot. We have very little data on characterization of the solid waste coming out of these drilled wells. And most of it's coming from Pennsylvania and West Virginia.
And they're raising the level of water drinking.
Right. So this is all, why are we raising these levels? So that the background levels, it's harder to tease out the effect of the industry from the background levels. And you might say, well, this is a nefarious thing to do that. Well, I would argue it's not so much nefarious as it is just a way to keep business as usual going. That's really what we're seeing in Ohio, West Virginia, and Pennsylvania. So where does this speak to? What, this resource curve, whether this is water demand, which I'll get to in a second, sand, chemicals, land, you name it. Why? Why are they becoming so resource intensive, yet they're not getting more and more oil and gas out of the well? You would think marginal production would increase with regard to this. The reason is because we don't price the resources that they use the way that I would say, holistically. The price really kind of in a way that removes any of what you might think of as the environmental externalities or the social externalities or the health-related externalities. That is, the costs that are borne onto the community or the landscape over the long term. those costs are not being incorporated in how we price water specifically in the state of Ohio for the oil and gas industry. And I'll get to pricing in a second, but let me just back up for 1 second. This is a graph that I've been keeping for, since 2010, where I've been quantifying the average amount of water used by our oil and gas wells in the state of Ohio back to Q3 2010. And I just updated this up until the first of the year, or maybe January of this year. And you can see this is an up and away trend. So that means that they're using more and more water per well every single month. In the beginning, in the current narrative, in the media, is these wells use about 5 million gallons of water per well. Well, 5 million gallons, as the kids would say, is so 2011. Okay? That was back then. That's what they used back then. Now, our average wells are using about 16 to 18 million gallons per lateral. We have wells in Noble County that are going to be using 87 million gallons of water for one well, for one lateral. So anyway, this is an 8 to 12% per year trend. And what is this resulting in? Well, it's resulting in really, really desperate. Yeah, Bill.
Where are they getting the water from?
Good question. And we'll get to that in 1 second. If you just give me 1 second. Well, I'll tell you how they're getting it now. And we'll say where in a second.
Well, actually, for our area, they've got permits already to take it from Mifflin Lake and Pleasant Lake.
So that's where that, the area that they're getting it from now is the Muskegon Watershed Conservancy, which is the big one. And I don't know if Mifflin
Lake. For our area.
So this is a shot right here. This is of a water pipeline that Gulfport put in Captina Creek, which is down in Belmont County. Captina Creek is this really beautiful watershed that has the Hellbender Salamander, has Pileated Woodpecker. I'm really fascinated by it. It has a huge thriving bald eagle population. It's not an agrarian landscape, it's more of a forested landscape. But this is what we're doing. We're putting it in these pipelines all over the place to suck water out of creeks, first and second order streams, lakes, reservoirs, you name it. And this is how they're getting it out. Pass over that. I'm going to kind of skip around if you don't mind. Where the water has been coming from traditionally has been the Muskegon Watershed Conservancy District. The Muskegon Watershed is this really large closed watershed in southeast Ohio, which services about, I think, 5 million people, something like that. It also includes okay, right. So the Conservancy District originally sold water to the oil and gas industry for about $9 or $7.25 per 1,000 gallons. Then they dropped that down to $6.25, and I don't know if it was Antero or Gulfport, which was first and which was second. Now they're selling water to the industry for about $4.25 per 1,000 gallons. What does that mean? Well, if you add up how much the industry spends on water and how much they spend on waste disposal, they're only spending about 0.25 to 0.28% of capital costs on water and waste. So you all have your checkbook and you balance your books every year and you just take your taxes. Well, if there's something that comes across your desk that you're only spending 0.25% of all costs on, it's not going to be something you're going to be too crazy worried about, right? Well, same goes for these guys. They're not getting charged anything for the water. They know that they can get the return on investment at the wellhead, so they're ramping up water demand because they're not really paying for it. So we've done some work at Frac Tracker where we've looked at what is the price signal that we can get to. Again, there's going to be those that say, hey, that's really not a win. But for me, at this point, until we can kind of get our heads around, renewables and fossil fuel exploration, a win for me would be at least to get these guys to bend their water demand curve at some point. Because right now I don't see it slaking, right? It's just constantly going up and up. And the best way that we can get at them and get them to lessen their water demand is to get water, the way that we price water, to be something like $22 to $35 per 1,000 gallons. At that point, you would see water efficiencies come into play. But until then, we're kind of just talking about both sides of our...
At our last meeting, Butler said that they were going to brought up, they have a new way of doing this without using any water now.
With
propane, actually, and then they just extract the propane.
Yep. And I think that's gonna be invoked by these guys. I mean, if they start to have to pay for water, like really pay for water, they might do that.
Isn't it too late now? They have the permit.
Yep, yep. I mean, I'm thinking like in Michigan and Illinois, some of the places where it's pouring right now. You know, the hope is that we can maybe get water to be priced. But I want the MWCD to price water more effectively, more holistically. At the least, they can do that. Because the way that the MWCD looks at this water that they're selling to the oil and gas industry is some sort of surplus commodity that they don't know what they're going to do with, so we might as well monetize it, sell it to the industry, make some money off it. Indeed, I understand I'm sympathetic to the idea that you need to generate revenue. But these guys aren't, there's only one place that they can go for the water. It's the same thing with oil and gas. Canard that the oil and gas industry said, if you don't let us go here, we're going to go someplace else. You're not going to go anyplace else. This is where it is. You have to get it here. Now you got to deal with the price regimes that we've created. And it seems like no one really wants to do that. This is a model that we built. This is a watershed budget model that we did where we're trying to figure out how much, what percentage of the Muskingum watershed's available water after everyone's taken their cut is the fracking industry taking right now, and will they be taking into the future, out to 2020? We did this model 3 or 4 years ago, so it's out of date, but it gives you a sense that we broke out water demand across domestic, industrial, irrigation, livestock, mining, and fracking. And indeed, you can see that every other sector is either stable or becomes more efficient by which they use water. The only one that isn't is fracking.
They are already using more water than we get in rainfall in Ohio.
Yeah, and you know, and that's the thing. The soil water conservation districts, are sympathetic to that. I think that you're seeing some of them starting to say, look, we have a landscape that we're altering in the name of getting pipelines and well pads and compressor stations. But we also have, with climate change, we're having less and less intense rain events, which is inarguable. The data backs that up. So you have an ecosystem, or you have a watershed, and this is the Muskingum watershed, giving you a sense that's Columbus, Akron. Did I put any other cities in there? Well, Columbus, Akron, that gives you a sense of what I'm talking about. This is a landscape that functions in a certain way, with respect to the way that it takes in water, the way it processes water, and the way it distributes it. But if you keep having all these pads coming in, pipelines coming in, compressors coming in, injection wells, this, that, the other thing, this landscape is no longer going to function the way that it used to. That's A. And then B, you also have a landscape that's receiving and processing water in a different way because the water is coming in a different way. It's more intense, less frequent rain events. So this watershed, this kind of bathtub, if you will, is not able to process water the way that it once did. Yep, go ahead.
Who's responsible for setting the price on that water?
Excuse me, Conservancy District itself, its board. Yep. The way that they look at it, they talk to the Corps of Engineers and they say how much water do we need to keep the people around these, our Tappan Lake, Clendenning Lake, Seneca Lake, happy for, you know, the purposes that they need it at. And then anything in excess of that, we can sell off. And that's the way that they go about their business.
Well, why'd they lower it from 7.25 to 4.25?
I don't know. That's good torque. Yeah. The rumor is it's going to go up to 6.25. But the point is, it's still far below what anyone would call a reasonable price for water, especially when you consider how little they're spending on the water as it is. There's just, the point here is that when you hear an industry talk about market forces, market forces, market forces, and yet they don't even want to hear the basic kind of hydrological market forces that everyone's suggesting. They don't want to kind of practice what they preach. And so that's...
Well, they're trying to privatize all water right now,
right.
And all the big shale investors are now investing in water.
Right.
Nestle CEO made a statement that water is not a human right, it should be paid for. And don't forget that all this water going in these injection wells is gone forever. It's taken out of the water.
Right, and the question came up earlier, just came up, how did they come to the number? How they came to the number is they cut and paste some of their traditional pricing schemes, modified them at the margins, and then said, let's call it a day. So basically what they did was, they've had a certain way that they priced water for many, many years. Now they have this other industry that, as this lady just mentioned, is coming in and using water the way we've never seen anyone use water. Because granted, I use water and I affect water quality. A farmer uses water, he affects water quality. We've never seen someone affect water quantity to this degree. And yet we're going to price water for basically the same way that we did for all past water demand. So it's a really tricky spot.
Are you familiar with the law in Ohio, a small town, they let them take water in their reservoir, and it was down so many feet, so they stopped them from taking the water. And they sued the town because they said they had a right to take that water.
Yep.
But they were running out of water for the whole town.
Yep.
Because they took it all.
Yep.
They were taking it all.
Yep, and that gets back to this graph right here. So one of the other ways that we look at water demand from the oil and gas industry is their demand is residential water demand. And you can't see this x-axis right here. It's probably hard to see some of the bars here. But needless to say, these red bars right here, these are, we looked at water demand from the oil and gas industry across, one, two, three, four, six states and a bunch of counties where oil and gas demand, or oil and gas has taken place. Unconventional oil and gas withdrawal is taking place. And then what we did was we asked a simple question. What is the oil and gas's water demand relative to residential water demand? And across these states, they average about 13.6% of residential demand. So if you take all the water that everyone uses in a county, and then you say, what is it, this new industry that's come in that's totally changed the way that we do business, what are they using? They're using about 14% of residential water demand. But the important thing to keep in mind is there's a couple counties here in Ohio, Carroll County, Harrison County, I think that must have been Monroe County right there, where their average demand exceeds 25%, and in Carroll County it was 85%. 85% of residential water demand is being used by the oil and gas industry in Carroll County. It was 3 years ago that we did this work, so I should be updating this on. It's not that I'm lazy, I just kind of lost touch. Look at Doddridge County. This is Doddridge County, West Virginia. That's 200% of residential water demand. Two times what the residents are using water, the oil and gas industry is using.
People's wells are going dry.
Yeah, people's wells are going dry. They're asking for these water buffaloes. And again, none of this cost is being incurred by the oil and gas industry. It's just being kind of foisted back on the community. And that's a tough one. Let's see, maybe I'll skip over that for the sake of time. I just wanted to give you a sense, this is obviously an Ohio-themed presentation, but I did want to give you a sense for some of the work that we've done nationally at Frac Tracker, where we've compiled water demand data for like 60,000 wells across the United States, and we've broken that data out into shale plays, and we've looked at that same time series, that same water demand trend across a bunch of different shale plays, and you can see Ohio indeed is not alone with regard to water demand inflection points. This uptick in water demand per well, it's happening everywhere, the Bakken, the Denver in Colorado, the Marcellus, the Midland Formation in Texas. 20% per year in Midland, 15%, 22% in Denver, 11% over in the Marcellus. So the demand is going up at an annual rate that is just not sustainable. This is an industry, unconventional oil and gas industry, that in my opinion was kind of bloodless to begin with, and they're becoming more so with regard to
Have most of those areas already have fracking in all the shale plays? Aren't you one of the last?
Yeah, we are one of the last. Yep.
Is that because it was banned in Ohio and previously?
I'm sorry, ma'am.
Was it banned in Ohio previously?
Fracking?
Yeah.
No, fracking was never
banned. Oh, it
was? No. It's just, it was a migration thing. I mean, there was, they knew that the Utica Point Pleasant extended in Ohio and they were looking at Pennsylvania, West Virginia. Let's just go over the river. So then let's transition a little bit into waste production and disposal, because you can't talk about water without talking about waste. And the reason I know that is because we've looked at the relationship between water used in the fracking process and brine, that is the liquid waste produced in oil and gas wells in the state of Ohio. And this is that graph. And some of you are statisticians, you can see that this is a really tight fit. Even if you're not, you can see it's a tight fit. What you see on the x-axis down here, this is the average amount of water used per well across like 20 counties in the state of Ohio. I did this analysis like 3 years ago. And then on the y-axis going up, you can see brine produced, the average brine produced. So as water demand goes up, brine production goes up. What did I already show you, that inflection point across the country in here in Ohio? Water demand is going up at a 15 to 25% rate, which means there's going to be more brine produced, which means we're going to be putting more pressure on injection wells, permitting more injection wells like the ones in Brookfield, Ohio, Trumbull County, and repurposing other wells to become Class II injection wells.
Cabot wants to sell it to us for growth and new storm wells.
Right, and so then that gets back to SB 165, this idea that this is a commodity that you should use as an icing substitute in the winter. Well, the problem with that is we just don't know what's in this stuff. The sample size, you know, statisticians talk about sample size. The sample size for what we know the chemistry of this brine is just, it's unacceptably low. So we can't make legislation, we shouldn't be making legislation that makes it easier to dispose of brine waste on our roads or inject it in communities if we don't know the basics from a data standpoint here in Ohio about what's in this stuff, where it's coming from, what roads it's taking, and how it's getting there. And that's one of the big things that with us is just, you know, in some ways, Ohio is really good on the data front. DNR can be really good on some fronts. But in many, many ways, it's really bad. And the worst way that it's really bad is with regard to the waste from this industry. Because you can sell production gas, you know, the energy independence, you can sell this is oil gas as a job creator. The energy independence obviously was used a lot. You can sell that to the cows come home. And that definitely is the whole cake component of this. But the spinach of this, which is what we all have to eat eventually, right, to stay healthy, is the brine, the waste production from this industry. And that is the real dark Achilles, that's the Achilles heel of this industry, which is why the data is so opaque.
They claim that they can reuse a lot of that.
Well, they don't reuse a lot of it. That's the problem.
They claim that at their meeting.
Right.
But I've read that 30 to 70% of it stays in the ground, they can't even get it out.
Right. And the point with reusing it is in states where water is priced at north of $15 to $20 per 1,000 gallons, they indeed do recycle.
Oh, but now since they have the permits to take it out of our lakes, did they get it for free or are they gonna have to buy it?
The ones you're talking about, these lakes you just mentioned, I don't know what.
Is it a permit just to take all you want for free?
No, it's not all you want. I mean,
they set limits on that.
Yeah, they set limits, but I would be interested to see what they're going to charge them. So I mean,
yes.
Again, the going rate is $6.25 according to MWCD, but you know, that's what they do.
Well, they have to do.
Yeah. So then this is another graph, and I like this graph for one reason only. This is a graph I haven't updated since middle of 2014, but the point really is that what this blue line shows, this is average volume disposed on a quarterly basis in our class 2 injection wells in the state of Ohio, back to 2010 up to the middle of 2014. Don't worry about the units, none of that really matters. The point is this is the average amount, okay? But then there's a company called Stallion Oilfield Services that bought up a couple of class 2 wells, 12 of them mainly. These are the wells that it bought. Now look at the average volumes of the wells that it bought. It wasn't random, it bought the wells in on 7/24, it bought the wells in 2012, the middle of summer of 2012. Stallion Oil Field Services, the kind of, I call them the black water of, if you don't know that reference, you have to look it up in Iraq War, but I call them the black water of oil and gas servicing companies. This is when they bought the wells, and you don't see the perforated line right here. It wasn't random the wells they bought. They bought the ones that are taking in the most volume. And then look what happened when they bought them. You see another inflection point going up. So what is it? Why is that important? It's because there's two people that own these class 2 wells. There's the small mom and pops, like the Danny Long well that I showed you outside of Canton. And then there's these large firms that are buying up a bunch of class 2 wells. Heckman Water Resources, Stallion Oil Field Services, they're all buying up these wells. Why?
How much can one of those wells hold, though?
Well, I mean, you have to go back to the individual permit, and I mean, it depends on
how deep it is.
Right. It depends on this, you know, the porosity of the system.
And I've heard they can use the wells when they're done fracking them and just reclassify them as injection wells when they're done with production.
They can. That's what I was talking about earlier. These volumes mean that more and more of that is going to happen.
Right. We're going to have more and more.
Right. You can have a well that you thought when you rode down the road, you said, oh, that's the Gulfport, you know, Jim Smith well, the frack well. No. Now it's a class 2 injection well, and
right.
You have to go at contact on underground injection control.
And I've heard they can bring nuclear waste in from the nuclear plant to put in these wells as well.
Yeah, speaking a little bit out of school on that, I can't confirm or deny that.
Right.
But, is there another question?
Would you feel comfortable in asking for the rest of the presentation that comments are held?
So all right, so I'll just I'll try to zip through it so we can have, so we have time to talk about it. But here's the point. The take-home point is you have companies coming in the state of Ohio, buying up wells, cornering the market in the name of going public on Wall Street. And what's the goal here? The goal is hey, Wall Street, even if this whole fracking revolution peters out, they're going to keep producing brine, and we've cornered the market. Instead of 10 cents a gallon for disposal, because we own so many of these wells, we can charge 40 cents for this for disposal. So there is a Wall Street kind of big picture thing that we have to keep in mind here. Fracking in Ohio in any one county is not just unique to that county. You are a part of, once you go into fracking, once you start fracking the state or injecting the state, you're part of a geopolitical kind of conversation. It's hard to tease out your individual county unless you, that's really the way that we need to think about it. Let me skip through here, sorry. Another point about these injection wells, this is a graph of our 245 plus class two wells and when they were approved and when they were drilled. So it's a cumulative thing, right? What does this tell you? Well, it tells you back in the 80s, 70s and 80s, you had a huge boom in class two injection well approval and drilling. And what I would argue is those wells, if you look back at their permits, the idea that they were designed for the pressures and volumes they're under today, I think that's a dubious assumption. These can be very old wells. Some of them aren't so old. Brookfield, they're drilling three injection wells right now. But these can be really old wells. This is the Dietrich well in Ashtabula County. This is one of the most productive, I put that in quotes, taking in quite a bit of waste from, 90% of the waste that comes in this well is from Pennsylvania. This is the police well that was shut down outside of Youngstown because it was resulting in quake activity. But this is what's taking in all this waste. So this is kind of gets back to Donald Rumsfeld's great quote about the known unknown, right? We know that these are class two wells. We know that they're taking in fracking waste. But beyond that, there's quite a few unknowns that really do need to be fleshed out in Ohio. And we're not doing that. And that's the rub. That's the rub. The next two slides just give you a sense for what these injection wells look like. Just in case you haven't seen them, some of you might know what they look like, and for that I apologize, but this is just essentially what they look like. I'm not gonna read out all the names in that, but one thing I will mention is this Eastern Petroleum Services, Inc. I put that slide in there 2 years ago. This was bought by Heckman Water Resources. So this is another one of those wells. This is Trumbull County. This is another one of those wells that 85% of its waste is coming in from Pennsylvania. And if you talk to the guys that work at the guard shack like I do, they'll tell you that they haven't experienced bigger months in the last 3 months since they came on board. Heckman bought this well because they know what I know, which is that these wells are really productive. They can make a lot of money off them. So this is the type of infrastructure all throughout the state of Ohio, you know, that we don't know it is even there, but it's there. And there's almost 250 of them. And I wouldn't hesitate to guess that there's going to be more of them, either newer ones or repurposing the old oil and gas ones. You've seen that. Let me just show you this one. This is Ashtabula County, and this one really worries me because this is again a very productive class two injection well, right in Ashtabula, so right on the PA border. The one that worries me about this is because you have a bunch of brine trucks speeding to and from this site from Pennsylvania and West Virginia. And you also have a huge Amish community right around here. And I don't think I need to say any further about that. But there's all sorts of issues about these brine trucks and what we know, state troopers know about how many brine trucks spill and explode or whatever it is. But again, the gap in what we know about where the stuff is coming from, how it's getting there, and you know, who's permitted to dispose of waste, it's just too big. It's too big. These are some of the mega ones. This is the Clearwater one. This is in Guernsey County. These are both in Cambridge, if any of you know that. I think it's 70 and 77, I think is that way. Cambridge comes together. So this one is to the southwest corner of that intersection between the two highways. This is to the northeast corner of those two highways. You can find both of these. You just get off the highway. I photographed these a couple weeks ago. This gives you a sense for how much activity was at these two wells the day that I flew on. Roughly 85,000 gallons of waste depicted here, or nearly 5 swimming pools worth of waste. 17 brine trucks in total at the two sites at only one moment in time. There's a tremendous amount of activity at these sites. But this just gives you a sense of what we're talking about. These are the mega shops. There's a couple other ones right on the Ohio River, but most of our wells account for, you know, a small group of our wells account for a lion's share of the waste disposal in the state. Let me show you this one. This is another waste, and this is more to what we don't know than what we do know. When you drill a well in the state of Ohio, you're going down a couple thousand feet, you're going out a couple thousand feet, right? The laterals, that's what we know, the fractured laterals are about 7,000 feet on average. But those laterals are getting longer by about 2.9 to 3.4% per year. When you drill down and you drill out, you collect rock. They call it drill cuttings. That rock can be radioactive and oftentimes it is. And there's people like Julie Weatherington in Brightstown in Ohio that can probably speak better on that. But needless to say, this stuff can be pretty hot. And it's going into our landfills. It's coming in from Pennsylvania and West Virginia, just like the liquid waste. The problem here is that Ohio EPA, DNR, Department of Health have issued advisories on the drill cuttings topic in the state of Ohio. And they basically are saying, go ahead, landfills, take it in. And the only advisory that they're issuing to those landfills is you might want to collect leachate, outward leachate from your facility. You might want to. You definitely shouldn't, but they're advising you might want to. So we don't know how this is affecting water quality downstream. But the other big point is, depending on who the landfill is, and this data was compiled by the Columbiana Harrison Carroll County Solid Waste District and a woman named Barb Walton, is that we don't know how much is coming to our landfills. The only reason I know this data is she's been collecting this data voluntarily on a monthly basis. She's not required by the state to collect this data. And she stopped collecting this data last year because she didn't have time. So this tells you we just have no sense for the volumes that we're talking about, the tonnages that we're talking about. You can see this is 2011 to 2016, so this gives you a little bit of a picture. But needless to say, this says for 6 landfills in the state of Ohio. This does not speak to the entire amount of waste coming in the state. And depending on the landfill that you talk to, they'll tell you this is a new source of waste and we'd have no idea how to process. Or this is just filling in the deindustrialization of the Midwest. It's filling in that void. So depending on the landfill, they'll give you different answers. But these landfills are taking a tremendous amount of waste. It can be radioactive. And you know, this is just one of those big million questions. It's like, we need to know more. We need to require landfills to parse, violate my waste and your waste from the oil and gas industry's waste. And we're not doing that. So this speaks to, This is your point about the waste pits. This is one of the most notorious wastewater impoundments in the state of Ohio, in my opinion, and I've seen probably 30 or 40 of them. This is Consol's wastewater impoundment. This is in Noble County. This is Senecaville. Yeah, Senecaville. This is just west of Senecaville. This is just a nasty site. I took this picture same day I took those Cambridge Class 2 well pictures. You can see, so what are those trucks? Those are brine waste trucks that are backing up to these wastewater impoundment pits. Connecting them to the pump. Here's one this was not the same day. This was a couple months ago. This was like 3 years ago. You can see these brine waste trucks connect to the pump and they just push all their waste into these impoundment pits. And your point about slitting the middle and draining it, I can't speak to that. I have no idea. But what I can tell you is these things drain out pretty quick. And I know that they drain out in the winter when no evaporation is happening. So that's all I can tell you. And you can see how many times I've photographed this thing from every different angle. I've photographed this thing in, you know, 2 weeks from each other. And one day this thing is massively full like this, and who knows what's in that. Next day the thing's empty. So I don't know. Then you go to DNR and you ask, hey, DNR, where are these things? And Leah Harper and lawyer she's working with, Leah Harper, someone in Atlanta, I know, they went to DNR and they had the chief's orders, the DNR chief's orders, and they said, well, you know, where are these things? Well, it turns out there's like 60 of them across the state. But the problem with that is it's 25 of those. Where they are and what the DNR knows about where they are P.O. boxes, okay? So that's a real problem. That's basically telling you that a third of these nasty sites that stand to probably increase in number and size, DNR is not keeping track of them. They only know where they're leaving, or whatever field box, maybe that's a legal residence, I don't know. The other thing is who's disposing of this? Who are these brine waste trucks? Where are they coming from? Well, Turns out that most of the brine haul are certified to dispose of waste in the state of Ohio, or Pennsylvania and West Virginia based. One of the big nastiest companies, and I think that this is the same company, I can't tell you that for sure, but there's a company called Royal Flush, which is out of Pennsylvania. I think those are all their trucks right there, because I've seen them there before.
Right.
Royal Flush is out of Pennsylvania, but we know they have a yard just north of Barnesville. And you go to DNR and you say, well, they got a yard right here, but you have them listed as a P.O. box in who knows where Pennsylvania. Mm. Well, you know, we just know where they listed on the form. That's not good enough. It's just not good enough. You are the primary receptacle for oil and gas waste in Appalachia. It's not good enough to not know where these guys are based, where they have their Ohio, landing sites, their Ohio yards. So this kind of gets back to that whole trend I mentioned in the beginning, which is that resource demand just keeps going up and away. And I'm not going to go into this too much, but this is the well pad. I think this is the purple haze well pad. This is right underneath Seneca Lake. The reason I mention this pad is you can see the numbers here. This well pad is going to be using about 4,400 gallons of water per foot of lateral, versus the average in the state of Ohio, which is 1,000 gallons per lateral foot. So that's a fourfold increase in water demand. That's insane. You also have the fact that these are traditionally our oil and gas laterals in the state of Ohio have been about 7,500 feet in length. The laterals go out 7,500 feet in length. The new ones, and you can see here, you can get a hard view to see here, but this is Seneca Lake. Let's just imagine Seneca Lake is right here. Right in this area right here, you have this zone of what we'll call super laterals. Over 3 miles in length. So 21 to 22,000 foot laterals. So all those trends that I've been describing to you that are going up, we did that analysis before we knew about these. So all that analysis just gets thrown out the window because it's like, this just throws us on our head. Because if this is the new normal, then we've got a real problem. And I worry that what we're talking about where you all live is, you're talking about the bottom of the barrel with regard to fossil fuel exploration. Look up to Michigan. Look at Antrim and Grayling counties, Michigan, where they explore for oil and gas, same way they're talking about here. Look at how much water they use there, 30 million gallons per well. So whenever you talk about moving out to the perimeter of the sweet spots of these plays, you're talking about this kind of stuff. Pretty scary trend. Quickly, I'm going to go through these pipelines. We got some money from the Hoover Foundation in Canton, Ohio, to fly an area from Columbiana down to Carroll County, from low oil and gas activity down to high oil and gas activity, with a high resolution 30 by 30 centimeter camera underneath the plane. We can generate this kind of imagery, so we can do the types of calculations to quantify how much of the landscape has been impacted by oil and gas development. I'll skip that one. But what I will say is that what we found basically was that the oil and gas well pads, the 4 to 5 acre well pads, are the least of our problems. For every well pad that you have about a 10 to 1 or a 15 to 1 acre demand for gathering wells. So this just takes the view that we take that it's just a 5 acre well pad and it's expanded out. Because to me, the well pads are the least of our worries. It's the pipelines that are being built. This is a nasty pipeline built by Blue Racer in Louisville County. This thing was put in January. They didn't even hydroseed it. So the idea that this is a stable situation here is kind of worrying. But it tells you that you're going to have a tremendous build-out of pipeline activity. This is that polygon. This is that area I told you from northeast to southwest. That's all these purple lines you see. Those are pipelines. The green dots are well pads. Don't worry about that. This is a kind of focusing in. This is Carrollton. Maybe you know Carrollton, Ohio. Anyway, this is Carrollton from the air. And what this tells, what our analysis showed us was that for the 11 county core Utica region, that's where, at the time, that was any county that had 10 to 15 wells or more in it at the time that we did the analysis. The DNR's projections for number of laterals runs its course. 20 to 30% of those counties will have been altered in the name of this kind of infrastructure. 20 to 30% of landscape. Non-trivial in my opinion. You can't do anything with those pipeline right-of-ways, by the way. Once they're in, I mean, you can plant them, but those are off-limits to anything beyond planting annual crops. Look at the Rover pipeline, look at the Nexus pipeline. You can't do much of that. You're still paying property taxes on them. And the idea that these gathering lines are in any way robust enough to handle the volumes that they're taking in is Just look no further than the pipeline explosion a couple months ago down in Santa Clara. Just to give you a sense, this is what these pipelines look like from the air. This is actually, I'm cheating a little bit, this isn't West Virginia, so this is going on. But needless to say, these other two are in Ohio. I took these photos in February with our partners at Lighthawk and Allegheny Front, a journalism group out of Pennsylvania. But you can see they're just cutting wide swaths through the state of Ohio. This is, I gotta lose track sometimes. This is the Rover pipeline. The rest of these are gathering lines. So this is the transmission line, this is a gathering line. But for the purposes of landscape change, land use change, they do the same thing, okay? And all of these pipelines that I'm showing you, these are the gas gathering lines, except for this one. These are not the water mains that I showed you earlier when I showed you those pipelines that were going into Captina Creek. We don't know, we can't pull that out from the data. We can't tell if something is a water gathering line and temporary, or if it's a gas gathering line and permanent, with some of the data that we have for those counties that we looked at. The area that we looked at back in Carroll County, we can, but with some of the satellite imagery we have, it's not as high resolution, we can't pull that out. This is the Rover pipeline. This is the Rover pipeline right here. Running through all sorts of landscape, and the idea that this thing is somehow robust enough, you know, it's just, again, it's a tough thing to make. And the reason I show you this pipeline, this picture, is because my wife worked in Alaska at a fuel station halfway between Fairbanks and Prudhoe Bay. And to get there, you take the Hall Road, and I've taken this road. The Hall Road goes up to Prudhoe Bay. And before you get to the Yukon River, the pipeline is on your left. Once you get to Yukon, it switches and it's on your right. It's above ground, and the thing is so tight that they can cut off a 1 or 3 meter section of the pipeline and isolate it, and cut it off from everything else if they realize something happened. Why? Because if something happens at a pipeline in January, February, in tundra country, that's millions of dollars that they're spending to clean that up. So they can do it right, if they have to. They're not doing it right. The Rover wasn't done right, the Nexus is being done even less right. And these gathering lines are just the worst thing possible among men, as far as pipelines are concerned. Let me leave that one. This one I want to show you, because this is just east of Bolivar, Ohio. And this is the Rover pipeline in the floodplain. You see that? Going like this. This is it. That's in the floodplain. I can't tell you how many times I've seen the Rover pipeline laid out in a floodplain. It's just not the way you lay out pipeline. It's just irresponsible. And we know from climate change that these 100-year floods, they're not 100-year floods anymore, right? More and more intense precip events are going to create more and more of these, which is going to mean more of this right-of-way, these right-of-ways, whether it's the Nexus, the Utopia, the Rover, gathering lines are going to be in the path of these floods. It's just a real problem. And again, what do we do with all this, you know, what do we do with all this landscape once you put this pipeline in? It's a big question. I'm not smart enough to answer the question, but it is a question that needs to be asked. This is Belmont County. I titled this slide, Appalachia Slopes and Pipes, an accident waiting to happen. This is what I've seen. This is Belmont County. This is leading down into Captina Creek. Did anyone hear about the big well pad explosion, the XTO explosion? They were a lot down in Belmont County. There was an Exxon explosion down in Belmont County. And when I was down there and I flew over that site, I also got a chance to take some photos of these pipelines that are being built. This is the Rover pipeline. I mean, that is a 35% slope that's going up and over. And this had not been fully, I mean, it was being hydroseeded in January. You can't be hydroseeding something in January. You have to have permanent cover in January. So it's just time and again. I mean, this is, I don't know what you people would call this, but I call that lipstick on a pig. I mean, it's just, it's really tough. It's really tough to look at. And this is kind of the environment that we're working in Ohio with regard to pipelines. It's just lay them as they go, get them in as fast as possible. Why? Because we need to get this product out to the global market so we can fully realize profit. That's what's happening. Okay, so this idea that eminent domain and people been talking about this with the Nexus Pipeline, eminent domain for private gain. And I mean, I don't know, it's a catchy slogan, but indeed it's backed up by the truth. This stuff is not being utilized here in Ohio. We're just putting this stuff at such a rate, we can't keep up with it. And that's a real problem. And I think the pipeline thing is just, it is an accident waiting to happen. And I'll kind of end with this slide and show you that indeed accidents are happening in real time. This is a gas gathering line running down into Captina Creek. I took this photo from about 4 or 5 football fields away from that summit of that hill right there. And then I kind of zoomed in right here. And you can see, look at all this subsidence. Maybe it's hard for you all to see back there. But you can see wherever there's these kind of like, moon-shaped locations right here. Here's one, here's a couple right here. This is subsidence, and I see this all the time. I see the fact that how we're putting these in and the way that we're covering them up, they're just meant to fail. The state of Ohio and the residents that live around this are going to be paying that price. And that's a real shame. So with that, I'll wrap it up 2 minutes later.
For everyone that enjoyed this program,
and if you would like to find more information on our area, Hayesville Community on Frack Gas Facebook page. And then my group, which I am the founding director of, is Friends for Environmental Justice at gmail.com. And invaluable information will be presented there. And on our local page, it is good to be able to tell people what's going on in our area. And we're looking at putting up a website so that whenever these water tests start coming in, we will be able to keep track of them. That, I think, is one of the most important things that we can do. And Frack Tracker also has a reporting set up within their organization. And if you go in and look at what they have found, you can see what we can do in our community as well.
Yep. And we're also looking to, I've been kicking myself the last couple of months that I travel around a bunch of states, primarily the states in Appalachia, Wisconsin, Minnesota, Michigan, and Illinois. I've been kicking myself that I haven't been recording the stories that I hear of people in the path of pipelines or injection wells or sand mines or whatever the case may be. Sand mines are largely dairy country in Wisconsin and Illinois. But the point is that if you all know anyone that wants to be interviewed, we're kind of trying to set up a library of interviews of affected individuals, kind of like if anyone listens to NPR, StoryCorps, something NPR does well. I'm trying to set up a model for that for our website where journalists and academics can use this audio to better inform their questions and their journalism, because I think a lot of times media and academics aren't asking the right questions. They're asking the questions that they think can get published. And in the state of Ohio, the perfect example of that would be everyone's focus on, well, rightfully so, if you live in the battle of it, the transmission lines, the FERC process and all that stuff. But if you go down to Southeast Ohio, none of those people are worried about transmission lines. They're worried about these gathering lines for good reason. And they're worried about injection wells and brine disposal and all that stuff. Some stuff that's really not that sexy, but indeed, if the goal here is to get those people in Eastern Ohio to be better informed and hopefully kind of demand more of their county representatives and industry, we need to focus on those kinds of things. So that's why we're collecting these stories. So if you know anyone that lives in the path, please have them contact me. Yep.
You know all the lousy things that are happening and what they've done. We didn't want to have that. What has worked to stop some of this? What has worked to slow it down?
Well, New York was pretty good.
I mean, what can we do?
Right. I mean, what I would say is, who's making the decisions where you live, the county level? Make sure that they're better informed. I mean, if you go to Medina County or you go to Belmont County, you go to Carroll County, these people didn't know what they were talking about, the county folks.
But once they do know what we're talking about, what can we do?
Now you're speaking of my favorite. I mean, now you're talking about that.
Now, what can we do? We're not going to lay down in front of fracking trucks. We know that's not what we can do. We don't want to be arrested or felonies or anything like that. But what we can do is whenever someone is in office that's not paying attention, like our local trustees. They're not paying attention. Run for office. Replace them. Go in there and do what you need to be done to protect your community. That would be my recommendation. And I was in Ashland County. I was also president of county planning for 3 years, and I sat on the county planning commission for 6 years. And our county planning in Ashland County is a model so that they can receive the funding. So that's not, you know, and I'm going to be presenting to them on this. So a lot of the county planning members are trustees. We also have a trustee association, and we also have a commissioners meeting every 2 weeks, I believe on Tuesday morning, if I'm not mistaken. So let these people know what's going on. I'd be glad to come and talk to anybody at any township level or your groups or something, and we can bring information in. We also, Ted also, if you would look onto, he was mentioning the interviews. What he's talking about there is called story mapping. And he would be, for example, somebody wants to talk, but they don't want their face to be shown, or their voice might be recognizable. So we can hide those things. You can still talk and you can still get your story out. And it would be identified to a geographical location, but it doesn't tie it to you and that protects you. So I think that's important for you.
Yeah, I think you could also, I think that the, you know, the Farm Bureau and the Soil Water Conservation Districts.
Well,
the ones that are in the Muskingum Watershed Conservancy District, they've been the kind of canary in the coal mines. I mean, they've been going to the resource court. There's a resource court that the MWC meets every year where they kind of talk about some of the water pricing metrics and land use protocol and all that stuff. And then the soil water conservation folks in that watershed have been coming every single year and saying, look, we can't continue to sell this water. Like, you're talking about selling a commodity, you're talking about looking at something as a commodity when it's an asset that we need to price more realistically. And it's an asset that we can't guarantee we can process and steward in the future given climate change scenario. So all I'm saying is that some of them have been pretty progressive.
Okay, but John, who runs this Well, it's
every single county within it has a court, county court, county judge is on the board, and then
that. Private organization.
I mean, is it a 501c3? Is that what you're asking?
I don't think so. I think it's a commission.
Yeah, it's a commission.
Who elects these crazy people?
Who elects crazy people anywhere?
Yeah.
Your point.
I don't know who they are.
I think that they are appointed, probably, as I was appointed to county planning, that's probably an appointed position by our commissioners. I will verify that for you.
Judge Vasilio is the one here.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
Gathering lines don't need to be permitted at all by FERC.
They're not FERC, they have nothing to do with FERC.
So usually that would probably mean a lease saying that Cabin Oil and Gas can put those lines and connect the wells, I'm thinking.
Bingo, right.
Also, along this lateral, can you go over that again, how much more water that's using per foot?
So originally we were talking about 7,500 foot lateral, and using about 1,000 gallons per lateral foot. Now I'm not talking about drilling down, I'm talking about the lateral, the actual productive component of the well itself. These newer ones, what we'll call super laterals, are 21,000 feet in length, and they're using 4 or 5 fold more water per lateral foot. So 4,700 to 5,400 gallons per lateral foot.
For 5 times.
Four and a half to 5 times more.
The evaporator pits. That's what they're supposedly doing, they're evaporating, and then once the concentration gets down, what do they do with that?
No, the concentration goes up. It gets less diluted, right? Because you have less liquid.
But eventually you're going to have a point where you can't put more water in there because there's so much traffic.
Right. Well, yes. And the one that I showed you with all the trucks, there was a couple of Caterpillar excavators there all day. So who knows what's happening there right now?
Oh, they might be burying.
They might be burying it.
And that's a total, it's called total dissolved solids, and that's what's going to go into the landfill. And also when these fracking takes place, when they go down and they break up that shale bed, the shale comes back up too. So it's not just a water issue, it's a landfill issue as well.
Yeah, and the other thing is so if you are charging by the load, right, and you go to console and you say, hey, yeah, Royal Flush, I'll take all your brine off the Terry Johnson well pad. That's 10 gallons. This is about 10 gallons. And I'm going to go to the Clearwater facility, and I'm going to dispose of it there, because I'm permitted to dispose of it there. Well, if somewhere in between there, something happens, or I can put stuff someplace to make something go away in some way, shape, or form, and I'm only disposing of 6 gallons, well, that 4 gallon difference is a profit in addition to the profit I'm already making. So that's the kind of arbitrage that you're seeing in the state of Ohio. And these wastewater impoundment pits are they're the key.
We've got 160 some of them somewhere.
No, it's 60 some odd some of them.
We have 70 here in National Academy, class 2.
No, wastewater impoundment.
Oh, the wastewater.
Yeah,
okay.
We're talking about the impoundment pits.
Okay.
Yeah, so we have something 60, 65 of them. Okay. But again, I can only vouch for, I should say too, that the one that I showed you, that console pit, Chief Orders doesn't even have that pit on their list. I know three that I've seen that I've gone back to them and said, and I've taken pictures of that. First I asked the question, are these wastewater impoundment pits? Yes, okay, well they're not on your list. And I know of three. And this is just the old me who travels around a little bit.
That wasn't much work to find that out.
You just got to know. You know where to go.
It's a complete study.
Right. No, not at all.
Let's take a step. We got a question here and then two things back there.
Our local representative approved the brine trucks and stuff on our township roads and stuff like that. What's to stop them from going? Are there any way to reverse that trend down the road? Like if we decide to make it far? Leaving the valve open or pick up the brine or containers on the road to their waste facilities? Is there any way to reverse it and pay all the prices?
There's a process when a law or regulation is put on the books. It's called a referendum. And in order to get a referendum through, you must have a certain percentage of voters to sign your petition, and then it must be presented and it ends up on a ballot if you get your signatures. And I'll check into that more because I've never done one, but that's my understanding of how you change basic law.
I know they just approved the one that Brian Parsons got.
Yes.
On our township and Kelly.
Yeah, and that was done, and the reason that was done is because last year on the Ashland County ballot, someone had the bright idea to allow our county officials to make all of our decisions. I didn't catch it until the day before the election. So if I had known that, everybody else would have known too, and we could have done something. But at this point now, there's a window that you can do the referendum. So we'll check into that, and I'll be glad to work on that. I think you were next back there. You've been for a while.
Okay, so in an area very near me, it seems they've already started making the preparations to start drilling. Is there any way at all that this could be prevented from?
Once they've started drilling?
Well, they haven't started drilling yet, but
it's permitted.
Well, it's been permitted.
So, now what happens whenever these permits come up and we know that they're going to be applying for a permit, you can make comments to ODNR, and so there are ways that you can voice your opinion, and the more people that voice their opinion, it happens. Down on the Ohio River, Orsenco was a group formed to handle the fracking waste coming down in barges down the river. 100,000 people signed a petition, and we walked in and handed them 100,000 signatures. That would maybe move on to Washington. Sometimes that's how they handle that too. But no, your question is no. The answer to your question is nothing. And that's why it's important that we monitor what these people are doing and hold their nose to the fence. Because if they do it wrong, we can stop them.
we're slowing down, and sometimes that's all we're gonna get, but let's do that, that's important.
But yeah, you have to also pay attention to the SB 165 and HB 578. Those are two bills that are not baked, they're not done yet. They're still making their way through, and they can't go through, I mean, they're just inexcusable bills.
So our local representatives, so if we do our local representatives, say, hey, I want this House bill passed, or I want you to stand behind this, or you want them to, you know, stop it, then you voice your opinion, and again, that's how you do it with your vote. That's how we change this, is through a vote, and running for office. There was a question. I'm
going to
go over here, and then I'll get you
to okay, who exactly
regulates? Thanks for environmental justice.
Fed, state, county, city, township. Who can regulate this, and who can make things happen?
The transmission lines, the Rover and the Nexus and the Utopia, those are feds.
That's the fed.
Those are the feds. But all the other stuff that we're talking about, for example, the injection wells in the state of Ohio, state of Ohio has primacy over its injection wells. That means it has oversight over its injection wells. There are some states, Kentucky would be one, where US EPA has primacy. So they regulate, they oversee their injection wells.
But what exact division is it that actually regulates?
So DNR, Ohio Department of
Natural Resources.
Old DNR?
What division of old DNR?
Well, right. So the Ohio Department of Natural Resources Underground Injection Control Program, DNR UIC.
Okay.
They're the class two guys and gals.
Okay.
DNR Oil and Gas is going to do everything else. Ohio EPA has co-signed on a lot of these advisories, namely the landfill advisory. Okay. Department of Health has also co-signed on some of these advisories, the landfill advisory. But mostly who you're talking about is Ohio.
ODNR.
And there is an oil and gas provision with the part of that is going to deal more with the pipeline and those kind of issues. But when I get something that I want to talk about, I'm telling everybody. I'm not just going to make one phone call to ODNR. I'm going to call their boss, their brother, their sister, their mother, and they're going to hear what I got to say. That's the way you get it done.
But the DNR, Ohio DNR is not doing anything about the gathering. That's been dissolved back to the county. And if you go down to the counties and you tell them, like that one I showed you that was kind of, that I said hadn't been hydroseeded and it was put in January, one in the county, that was put in by a company called Blue Racer. And I was just, I hadn't seen that pipeline before. And I had been down there several times and all of a sudden it was in. You leave, you come back a week later and there's a pipeline in. And I contacted them, I said, Who's this? Who's put this in? I assumed it was Blue Racer. I said, well, we didn't even know that thing was in. I said, well, what do you guys know about the gathering lines? Because I never talked to the county about it. They said, we know when these pipelines cross county right-of-ways. That's it. But whatever happens in between, and you can see from my images, an extensive amount of activity and stuff happens in between. And
that's so basically your bottom line is county.
For the gathering lines.
County, and it's feds that put in the main line, and then and who puts in the gathering lines, is that still fed?
Gathering lines is all county.
The big transmission lines, not state.
Right, the big transmission lines that everyone's heard about that have names associated with them, you know, like they all have their pet names, the Nexus, the Rover, the Keystone, those are FERC, that's feds. But these little ones that I'm showing you right here as an example, those are county.
One of the things that they're doing is crossing state lines and calling it an intrastate instead of an interstate. So they're getting away with federal regulation by doing that. And FERC is under, FERC is Federal Regulatory Agency. They are under a review right now to make some changes. So if you visit Friends for Environmental Justice Facebook page, I put petitions on there all the time, and that's important. People say petitions don't work, but they do. You know, I mean, and if enough people voice their opinion and make that change, they're going to know that I'm not going to be able to represent you if I don't do what you want me to, and you are the voter.
Well, also, and you know, you remember during the 2008 crash, when they all talked about the SEC and the big banks are a revolving door. You work for one when your guy's in office, and then you go to work for the other when your guy's not in office. It's the same thing with FERC. They just kind of, you know, when my guy's doing his thing, I'll work for him. If he's not, I'll go to work for the private sector and back and forth.
Okay, who in the Fed is it that actually puts the gas line through?
There's a commission of five people, and they shut down, three people resigned to stop these pipelines last winter, and so they couldn't do anything for that whole winter because they had no one to vote on things. So, you know, there's, but right now there is, it's the administration in Washington that is controlling the comments, is what we're doing. Deborah, I think she had it. Oh, I'm sorry.
And as far as what we can do, I actually, quickly then, now this Thursday, the 3rd, 9 p.m., the county commissioners, pardon, yeah, 9 a.m., sorry, 9 a.m., at the 110 Cottage Street, where I have to be a meeting. We talked to one of the commissioners, who was simply sympathetic, or not, okay.
There is one that's sympathetic, because one of them is my neighbor. And he's not, he has a well right beside him.
No, I wish.
Can you explain the difference between gathering lines and pipelines? Exactly what is the gathering and what is the...
It's a good question. So they both function in the same way in terms of what goes through. But the gathering lines are basically, they're the arteries of the system, right? They're the veins of the system. They connect the nerve endings, the pads, to downstream infrastructure. Because this mega infrastructure, whether it's a tracking facility, these big crackers that crack open the gas and create a higher value product for it. Wherever those are, Marshall, Doddridge, Wetzel counties, West Virginia are an example. Mark West is a big company. They have one facility in each of those counties. Those are the hubs. And the spokes go out from there, connecting to the pads. So they take the stuff from individual pads and bring it to a centralized area where they can do something with it, or they can push it further downstream to processing infrastructure.
So liquid gas is in these lines?
Right.
And pipelines, what's in these interstate pipelines?
Gas or oil?
You have white girls as one.
Yeah.
Okay, so you said they're not being done right. Exactly what is not being done right?
Well, for example, the slopes, the average slopes of these pipelines, I mean, they're going up 30-40% slopes up and down huge hillsides. You don't put pipelines in that way.
Okay, but why don't you? Tell me why.
Well, because of this, because of what I just showed you, this.
Because of erosion?
Yeah, because of erosion. And then if that slips, what happens to the integrity of those seams, of those pipeline segments?
You mean the soil slips? Or?
Soil slips. Yep. And these things are 5 feet below the ground.
5 feet.
5 feet.
The one I saw in it's Harrison County. They dug what looked to me like a granite canyon. You just come upon it suddenly. It's that I think they call it the Utopia line.
Yeah, the Utopia.
And, they dug a huge valley right through the.
Right, but that's a transmission line too. Okay, so that's not what we're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Okay, you said yeah. Gathering lines are 5 feet.
Gathering lines are individual agreements with landowners to get the gas from the pad to the processing infrastructure and then further downstream. So this is an individual one-on-one transaction between landowner and pipeline company. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it's not, you know, there's no federal regulations for better or worse. There aren't any. I just don't think, I mean, I'm speaking a little bit I'm editorializing a little bit, but the landscape of Southeast Ohio and Northern West Virginia does not lend itself to a tremendous build out of these podunk pipelines all over the place. I mean, it's just not the way, the landscape will fail eventually.
Who maintains that lane after?
Good question.
Does the pipeline or is the landowner responsible
with
for maintaining that?
Right, with the gathering lines.
And what would your responsibilities be?
With the gathering lines, I have no idea who maintains them, I must admit. I don't know.
And I'm a landscaper, so.
Oh, okay, yeah.
There's a good job.
Yeah, there's a good job for you. I mean, there's a guy at Ohio State that's doing some work on, changes in commodity production on these pipeline right-of-ways, and then there's another guy at Ohio State. He's in Worcester at the Ag Extension. And then there's another guy down in Columbus at Ohio State who's looking at these as wildlife corridors, how to maximize them as wildlife corridors. But, you know, whether you can grow or more or less soybean or you can or cannot have deer running across these, that's another topic entirely. But who manages them, these gathering lines?
Who comes up with the laws on how this land is going to be managed afterwards?
In,
fed, state? county?
The northern part of Ashland County, there is a line, it's by Sunoco, it was a wartime line, and then they added another 8-inch line right alongside of it. And that is monitored by a community citizens monitoring group. And it goes 10 miles between compressors, so if something happens in that 10 miles, and they have not reached 10% pressure, that will leak forever. Yes, Dave?
Is this on PowerPoint that we can grab a hold of or YouTube?
Yeah, I can put it online.
Okay, I'll email it to you.
Yep.
This is kind of this is a weird question. Okay, so I'm hearing all this and I'm trying to absorb, I'm kind of new to this whole thing. So I hear what it can do as far as the damage, from leaking into our water system and such. And there was talk before you came tonight about water testing. Are we wasting our money? Other than, okay, we know where our water's at before all this starts, and we can see what potentially is happening to our water when these people come in and jump through it and start to do their thing. What if our water changes? What rights do we have as homeowners to come back to these people and say, hey, we don't have any water in there, but it's good.
That's a legal issue.
Right.
That becomes a legal issue, and there's a list of attorneys over here. You can ask questions. We try not to wear that legal hat, but it is. And we also have, if somebody wants to do something, there's attorneys available that can tell us what's legal, what we can do, what we shouldn't do, and what we shouldn't.
Okay. So are we wasting our money by having our water tested? No.
Okay. It's your only hope if they do destroy your water.
But that speaks to, that just speaks to where we are in Ohio. If you look at... who was I just talking to? I forget what the topic was now, but it was something having to do with this, and someone was telling me that they are, I think it was the Nexus pipeline, I think that was who it was, someone up in Lorain County was telling me that they've got a group of folks that are doing water testing up in Lorain County, ambient level water testing, like you're talking about, to have a pre-whatever
right.
signal. And there's a couple questions that come up. One is, are we testing for the right things? Can you afford to test for the right things? Is there a uniform methodology for collecting this stuff? There's so many questions that come up, none of which you should be responsible for. This should either be the company should be paying the price, but that has to involve third party. Or our DNR needs to be doing this. There's no uniformity. And so if you happen to test for X and, Jim Johnson or whatever down the street taxes for Y, or when I say down the street, I mean a different county and a different water monitoring group test for Y in a different way, you can't square that circle.
So personally, where we are right now, I'm not sure where this gentleman lives, but we are at a spot where they have cleared and they are getting ready to move in. So if I'm, how far away can I live where I should or shouldn't be concerned? And so just to pass on general knowledge, if you have someone that really doesn't know that any of this is going on and all of a sudden they're on top of them, it could be too late before they know.
I've been collecting the story that I just told you about for a couple months now, thanks to something Elaine and I have been talking about. And there's stories that I've heard about the Nexus pipeline that just crush me. I just met a woman who lives near the Big Wadsworth compressor station they're putting in for the Nexus. She bought a home, she moved here from Florida. The realtor didn't tell her. The neighbor, 2 days after she moved in, a neighbor comes in and says, you know what's moving in across the street? It's a compressor station. She put the house up for sale with the same realtor that she bought it from. She can't sell the home. Yeah. So those kinds of real estate-based questions come up time and again.
As a real estate agent, I will share this and I can put your question. You can have a property evaluation done based on a normal market, and then if something happens, and for example, I was at a public comment session on Rover on that compressor station, and I made a statement that if there's a pipeline running by, I won't list the property because I would not want to put someone in harm's way, and also that you're going to lose at least 50% of your value, and that depends on how close and how big the line is. And our county engineer made a comment that I'm surprised how many pipelines are in this county. No, I wasn't. Because I know, I've been to the frack tractor site, so yes, can I?
I got a couple questions. Do you think maybe getting, we're having one, this pad in Green Township is like 22 miles.
Thousand feet behind our house.
It's
1,000 feet behind our house.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first one.
Should we get soil samples as well? Because all that runoff is going to, it comes right down from his field into our property.
Oh, yeah, sure. Why not? I mean,
so,
can't hurt.
Is there something, or what should be asked of the test board? Is there,
okay.
I can answer that. If you want to join us on Monday, May the 21st, at Haysville Shelter House, which is the little shelter house in Haysville, we're going to be addressing what we are supposed to be looking for. What can we do?
Yeah.
And it'll do, basically the erosion, that's going to be the biggest key, because I have a lot of information on that. We have a presentation to do for you. So, and that will be at 6 o'clock, and that will be probably from 6 to 8, and that will be at, and it's on the 21st, and it will be on our Facebook page also. And if I have your email, I'll send you an email list, and you'll know when that event is coming up. We also do films at the Old Opera House, the last Saturday of the month. We've done The Black Snake Killers, which is the Standing Rock story. We're doing, I think this month we're going to do Blood on the Mountain, which is an organizing, had a lot to do with mining and unionizing and that kind of thing, and how industry takes us down. So that's one of our films. We're looking at Triple Divide, which is another one that we've actually shown here in the library. And that's about, we want to get into some conversations about pooling. So your neighbors have signed and they need more land to be able to make this work, and how that works, we want to discuss all of those things. So,
and I had a second question too. Right across the street from us is Richland County. If they are coming out 5,000 feet, like you're saying, they're going to hit Richland County and take their resources. Would Richland County do anything to stop them?
They haven't.
Yeah, and I mean, also as far as soil testing is concerned, I mean, Carroll County had a group that was pretty proactive at the outset in 2010 in soil and water testing and sampling. And I think that, you know, 3 years in, they spent a tremendous amount of resources and time on testing for the wrong things. And I would say that, you know, what Elaine's doing, I mean, you don't want to go down this road if the thing that you're testing for has nothing to do with what they're doing. But then you know, and but I mean, it gets back to what this lady said. I mean, in my opinion, this shouldn't be your job. You got better things to do, and it shouldn't be your thing. And as far as, you know, the other thing to keep in mind is with regard to oil and gas drilling in Ohio, it used to be that these drilling units, the area that they needed to drill, they called them like these 640-acre units, right? They needed 640 acres to do their thing. Well, I showed you those longer laterals in Southeast Ohio. With that has come larger drilling units. So now the drilling units are about 2,100 acres. So I'd just like to impress upon you, this has nothing to do with your question, but the fact that the intensity of resource demand and land acquisition that this industry is kind of going towards is really, really off the charts. And the other thing I wanted to point out is this Appalachian storage hub that I mentioned, this is not a storage hub that speaks in any way to the energy independence narrative that was talked about in 2010. This is a way to get the stuff out of the ground in Appalachia and state of Ohio, get it to the global market, so who can use it? China. Why do I call it? China is growing by leaps and bounds, and I would recommend that any of you that don't believe me, you go read, there was a special section in The Economist like 4 or 5 weeks ago called The Geopolitics of Energy. You can look it up. If you don't find it, send me an email. I'll send you my highlighted, annotated notes from it. But in that special section, China, gas, and the United States were mentioned in the same sentence like 5 times. So,
yeah. And China would have to drill a new well every day just
right.
to meet their demand. Every single day.
And they're not doing that.
And they're not doing it.
And look what they're doing in Africa.
And they're investing here in our country so that they can take the oil and poison us and take it over.
They're not doing that, and they're look at what they're doing in Africa and all sorts of countries. They're colonizing that area, and I'm not trying to sound conspiratorial, but the fact is like Elaine said, GDP, they need to get it up per person every single year by 9%, and they're not going to be doing it, like Elaine said, by drilling it on their own motherland. They're going to take our stuff. Yeah.
I guess I've got lots of questions, but first of all, there's a site just, and I can see it from my house. That's not an injection site, right? That's just a well they're drilling. The green township.
Yeah, you're talking the one on 2375.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a experimental fracking pad, and they are doing a test drill now. But it is, that's because they couldn't get the fracking pad permit that they wanted. But the intentions is to drill, to make that a fracking pad, which could be.
Okay, if I don't sign on to that, can they still go underneath me and?
Do they, in that area, a lot of the mineral rights were, Columbia Gas came in and bought the farm and then sold, kept the mineral rights and sold the land. So you're gonna see that quite often in that area. And there's, they can drill under you, but you still have protections for your water if you have your baseline testing and something goes wrong. You still have, you can still go after Cabot.
Okay, I had very extensive water testing done down at my property. I was part of a test group. And I had probably, you know, 100 different chemicals that they tested for. And I mean, everything came out clean, but that's like 15 or 20 years ago. Would that be inclusive in anything that's going on here, or would that be too long ago?
I would say that's too long. Yeah. I think that periodically you will need to do these testings again, just to keep on top of that. But like Ted said, the time that these wells are actually productive is that first year to 2 years, right. And it drops off tremendously. So that's the time period you really want to be watching for. So yeah. You've got your pre-testing.
So you're talking like 5 years?
When they're productive? When the wells are productive?
First couple years.
Yeah, first couple years.
Yeah,
they're done after 3 years.
But this experimental well, we have no idea what they're doing, and I don't think they do because they've never done it. And remember, they're drilling through gas storage areas. This whole one third of the county is a gas storage area. I would love to stay. We have to be out here. the 21st, follow our Facebook page and come back in, and you have my contact information.
Yeah,
I am not here. So you want to talk, call me up.
Okay.